This is a time-lapse video of a landscape study I did in VR in Quill using a Oculus Rift VR headset. The whole thing took about an hour, and I'm trying to do these studies kind of like under 30 minutes, but I'm learning a lot about how to use the tools and what techniques are best to achieve the look that I want to get after. And so there's a lot of trial and error and doing things kind of the wrong way and then redoing them, so it takes a bit longer than half an hour usually. And on top of that, I'm also not a experienced digital painter. My background is 3D, so that's part of the reason why I'm doing these studies. I want to get a better understanding of composition, color, and you know where to put what kind of detail, and how to describe certain atmospheres and lighting and stuff like that. So with these studies, I usually just look for some reference images first, and then I try to kind of recreate the general feel of the image in the 3D VR space. And Quill is kind of interesting, like a lot of these 2D, 3D painting VR programs, you're kind of painting in 3D. Or in a 3D space, but the output is essentially flat lit strokes, so it's almost like a 2D output. And so I'm trying to explore different techniques on how to kind of add shape to that, those flat colors. And you have a kind of a brush that allows you to colorize the strokes that you drew, and you can use different blending modes when you colorize them, and that way you can also kind of add gradients to your individual, you know, to the shapes that you already blocked out. There's a few issues with that. The main issue with it is the stroke resolution. So if you draw a single stroke, you can't really, you know, you can't add a lot of painted detail on the stroke. So you would have to basically, it's much better to add a whole bunch of small strokes and bunch them up together, so that you can kind of add more detail when you paint on top. And you'll see this in the video. It's a bit hard to put into words, but it does kind of present you with some, you know, some difficulty often on how to kind of render stuff out in a way that is readable. So here you see it's a single stroke, and it works kind of nice in the sense of like adding a gradient, but if I want to, this is kind of the road that you will see later on. So if I would try to colorize the edges of the road, it won't really allow me to do that. It'll kind of like block out, or it'll add color to the whole width of the road, whereas the length of the road is subdivided many more times, and so I can kind of color along the length. So again, this is kind of hard to explain, but you will see it as I start colorizing at some point. So what I'm doing here is I'm kind of, instead of using the colorize tool, I'm just adding brush strokes in different colors, and I find that to be kind of a better workflow for these kind of rough studies, because it kind of forces me to rely on my ability to color pick and block out the shapes instead of just like using kind of gradients to to colorize. So it is a little bit more difficult, but I feel the results are better as well. So this is a technique where basically I block out a bunch of strokes with different values and a little bit of a color variation, and then I bunch them up and place them on top of the road, and I can select however many strokes I want and then duplicate. And that's a way that you can very quickly kind of create a shape that has like some kind of texture without, you know, painting texture. So I'm adding some labeling my layers a little bit just to keep things organized. And for these paintings I kind of try to keep everything as much as possible on a small amount of layers. So here I'm going to add some roadblocks, and you see that I draw a line and I duplicate it a bunch of times, and that allows me to add a more detailed gradient on the shape. So now I'm just kind of like laying those blocks, they're kind of roadblocks, and you see it's easy to duplicate. It's very powerful. Not only can you duplicate, but once you've duplicated and moved, you can then use the redo function to kind of repeat the exact thing that you just did. And here's an example of me trying to figure out exactly like what's the best way to kind of describe in the most minimal possible way what this scene kind of is made up of. So instead of like keep duplicating those same blocks, roadblocks, I just add the ones that are very far from the point of interest, I just kind of add some strokes to emulate the roadblocks. And that's something that I'm really trying to figure out a lot, like where do you put the detail, and where do you kind of insinuate detail instead of actually blocking it out or detailing out the shapes. So I'm just adding some dirt under those roadblocks to have it blend a little bit more with the road. And with this painting I really kind of struggled a little bit. It was a difficult one. Now I'm gonna add I think gravel or tarmac sand, or I don't know what the right label is for them, on the side of the road. And this is all based on the reference image. And just looking at reference and trying to understand, you know, what gives something shape, and it's very useful to use the reference. So I'm trying to kind of build the feeling and the composition of this kind of sandy grass. And here you'll see when I'll try to colorize this a little bit, and I'm just pushing and pulling as well the shape. So there's like a push tool. It's not ideal, but see, so when I'm trying to colorize it, you end up like having very, it's not very easy to control exactly what you're doing, because different strokes are going to get colored more intensely than others, and then you end up with something like very contradicting gradients kind of, and doesn't really work very well. So that's kind of a part of the workflow I'm trying to figure out on what works best. So now you have kind of these flat colors laid on top of those kind of soft gradients, and that just doesn't look very good. So something to keep in mind for the future. So it's kind of a little bit tricky in the sense that I'm creating a 2D painting in a 3D space. So the idea is that it kind of gives me then the freedom to, you know, create a little animation or do something in this scene with cameras and composition that you wouldn't be able to do with just a flat 2D image. And the difficulty here is then, you know, you, like, I don't need to add all a huge amount of detail in areas that are far removed from this little point of interest road. And if I zoom out very far, you'll see that in the whole scene, the only detail that I really have is on that little small area of road with the roadblocks, and everything else around it is just incredibly, you know, it's very basically blocked out without any detail. And now I'm just building some tree that I'm gonna duplicate a bunch, and here you'll see again the issue of the level of detail, because there's a lot of detail going on in this tree and individual branches and stuff like that. And it's fine when it's close to the area of interest, but as it's, you know, as the trees are moving towards the distance, if I just duplicate that high detail tree, it's just gonna contradict the surrounding level of detail in the environment. So I'm just placing them and kind of looking at how far I can place this kind of level of detail without it looking weird. So I'm just figuring out the scale a bunch. The nice thing about working in VR is that you can really, you know, you can zoom out infinitely and you can zoom in infinitely as well. So now I'm kind of building just a tree that has less detail. So the branches are kind of, they're thicker, and I'm just like scribbling on top of them a little bit, and I just want to get the feeling of that type of tree. I think ideally I should probably make like 3 or 4 versions of this tree with different levels of detail and then place them in the distance. I end up just making these 2 versions, and then for the ones that are very far removed I just draw some, you know, some blocked out shapes, and I feel like in the end it worked out okay, but I kind of lost the feeling of those being trees. So but again, I wanted to, you know, keep this to, you know, at least under an hour, so I didn't want to waste too much time, because this is the point of this is not to learn how to draw detailed trees. For me, this is kind of a study of composition and color, and just getting more used to the tools, and also figuring out workflows working with Quill and these VR tools. So now that I have a bunch of detail or individual little strokes on the road, the gradient painting tool, it does become more useful. So the more little individual elements that your shape is made out of, the more useful the gradient and just colorizing tools become. So I'm just trying to, you know, add some variation of values, and I'm just kind of using the reference to figure that out. In the end, I feel like the whole thing ended up being a little bit too flat in color. And of course, the scene is very overcast and it's supposed to be kind of a depressing environment. But I think the whole contrast is ended up being a little bit too low contrast. So I'm also struggling a little bit here with the distant snowy mountains, and the problem what I ended up having there is that I used a very flat brush to draw the mountains, and so they just ended up looking like cards. So I ended up kind of drawing on top of them with a kind of a thicker brush, and that kind of worked out a little bit better. So my hope is that as I'm doing these studies, I'll just become faster at doing this, and I'll create kind of a bit of a visual memory, to where at some point I can kind of rely a little bit less on reference and be a little bit more kind of relying on my own creativity and just creating interesting concepts, because this is kind of it's not super interesting in terms of a concept, you know, it's just an environment, but it's definitely more useful for me to do these studies in VR using Quill than it would be to do it in Photoshop, because it allows me to get a better grasp on things like level of detail, depth, color, and how values and saturation is affected by distance and atmosphere. So, and then the added benefit of being able to just move around in the environment that you're creating is really, it's a huge plus. And I'm just a noob, you know, like I essentially suck at this. And I can imagine real experienced concept artists, what they could do with a tool like that. It would give them so much freedom. So if there's any experienced or, you know, just concept artists that are watching this video, I would just highly encourage you to start messing around with these tools, because I think it will give you a lot more flexibility, and I think most people will love this actually. So this is what I mean, I'm just kind of drawing on top of the distant mountains. And this was tricky, just getting the values right, because on the one hand it's heavily affected by the atmosphere, so it should kind of blend in a little bit with the sky, but on the other hand the snow is very bright, so I didn't quite nail it, and I definitely want to try it out a little bit more, that kind of distant snowy mountains, you know. But I do like the contrast between the brown environment and then the distant white blue mountains. And so now I'm just adding some interesting detail from the reference, just some road signs to help sell the whole environment. So that's it. I hope this was somewhat useful. These studies are definitely incredibly useful for me, and aside from the fact that they're very enjoyable to do, I feel like I'm progressing and learning a lot from doing them as well.